23rd Psalm, the psalm today after the first reading. I took out my prayer book and I started to read when the patient began to recite the prayer with me. She was prayerful, actually eloquent, but it was her sincerity that captured me. Despite her grave illness, the psalm comforted her. It gave her peace. Later, I reflected on the experience, and for some reason, an oratorical contest from college came to mind. I was in a public speaking class, and I was scared. The class must have been a requirement because I did not have the nerve to stand up in front of people and talk. There was a contest, and some students who spoke were powerful, and they were eloquent. It seemed that they knew and they felt what they were recited. And I said to myself, that's it. What moved me so much about this woman who knew the psalm by heart was that she knew the Good Shepherd. You could see it. The 23rd Psalm is perhaps the most requested psalm for many different occasions, especially wakes and funerals. And the reason is quite obvious. The listener feels a sense of peace and being cared for, as the words of the gospel today reinforce Jesus' love and comfort. And the psalm was written hundreds of years ago, before this, by King David. There was also the prophet Ezekiel in the Old Testament, who speaks of God becoming the true shepherd of Israel. Today in John's gospel, Jesus names himself the Good Shepherd. St. Peter's has a beautiful stained glass memorial right over there in the transept. It is a wonderful depiction of Ezekiel, and then below, with his symbols, and then below it is the Good Shepherd with sheep around him. You need to come up and see it later. In Jesus' time in Palestine, sheep were kept in a sheepfold, which was a circular wall, which was about 8 to 10 feet high, with a single opening, not a door, no roof. Several flocks from neighboring families might be placed together at night, and the shepherd, one of the shepherds was designated, lying in the opening to serve as a single door. Nothing could get in or go out without going through the shepherd. In the Middle East to this day, a shepherd still calls his sheep by name. Because a shepherd spends most of his time with the sheep, he knows the individual characteristics, the markings, the likes and the dislikes. And the sheep know the shepherd's voice. Even if someone other than the shepherd calls his name, a sheep will not respond. They listen for the one voice that they trust. The sheep don't need to be corralled and guided like goats do. They just follow the shepherd. And the work was tough for shepherds. Shepherds might injure themselves looking for sheep to bring in at night. The terrain was rocky. You could fall into a gulch. In protecting the sheep from wolves, or other wild animals, shepherds could be hurt or even die, and they were known to be loyal to their sheep. Now, Jesus refers to himself as the Good Shepherd. The scripture scholar Barclay refers to the Greek word kalos as a thing or person that goes beyond good to lovely. He then describes the phrase the Good Shepherd, similar to the phrase the Good Doctor. When people talk about a good doctor, they are usually referring to more than the doctor's medical skills, maybe looking to the doctor's compassion and kindness. Jesus shows himself to be a loving, gentle shepherd. The true shepherd is willing to die for his sheep, and Jesus says a good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. By a simple portrayal of sheep, the shepherd and sheep, he shows he is willing to suffer and die for his sheep. He is not talking now about his death as a possibility. It is now his vocation, but he's adding that he will rise up again after that, which is very important. Now, if there's a good shepherd, there's also a bad shepherd. A hired hand will not risk himself for his sheep. Tending sheep is just a job, a paycheck. He would sooner run away and let the sheep be devoured by wolves. So the hireling has no affection or responsibility for the sheep. If one sheep wanders off, the hired hand doesn't bother to go find him. In a sense, the hired hand is worse than having no shepherd at all, because he just gives the appearance that he's protecting. To him, it is not a calling, and his attitude puts sheep at risk. Now, a good shepherd knows his sheep, and his sheep know him. It is not a passing recognition. It indicates a relationship. How well do you know your spouse, your children, your parents, or a good friend? After years of living or working with someone, we get to know them pretty well. After 42 years of marriage, I knew my husband very well, or so I thought. It always amazed me when John said or did something I would have never predicted. I always avoided cooking or baking with coconut because John was allergic to it. We were at a wedding, and when I returned to our table after talking with a friend, there he was, eating a piece of cake with coconut on. He announced he was no longer allergic to coconut. Had been eating it for a while, and didn't I know? News to me. And then there was my daughter, Kristen, who for years hated purple and wouldn't wear any clothes that were purple. While going to a bridal shop to pick out bridesmaid dresses, Kristen chooses purple as the color for her gowns and wedding decorations. Go figure. We never know everything about a person, no matter how close we are. It is impossible. Yet Jesus knows everything about us and compares this relationship with his Father. The unity of Father and Son is a major theme in this gospel. Jesus desires that his sheep might enter into a mutual relationship and bond of love and trust existing between the Father and the Son. The Father loves the shepherd because he will give his life for his sheep and in obedience to him. And this Jesus does willingly. He came into the world to die on the cross, to rise again. And it is his death that saves us from death. When Jesus does leave, he will not abandon us or leave us comfortless, because instead he gives us the gift of the Spirit, the Holy Comforter. Here's the Trinity in action. Jesus' job does not end here. He's not only rescuing the present sheep, but he's going to bring in more sheep, different from the ones that he already has. The original sheep are the people of Israel. Those ready for his call hear his voice and follow him. But Jesus is not only interested in the people of Israel. He is opening to the whole world. The Gentiles are no longer the enemy. They are sheep to be brought into the fold. Fast forward to today. What does it mean to have Christ as our shepherd? And what kind of flock are we to be? First, we need to know what it means to be a sheep. Jesus talks about this common denominator of sheep and shepherds, and we have some hesitation because of its negative connotations. Sheep are known to be followers, sometimes stubborn, sometimes dumb. We enter the sheepfold through the opening where the shepherd is serving as the gate. Through Jesus, we know his voice. He calls us by name. Through this opening, through Jesus, we find access to God. Jesus opens the way to God because the gate is not a barrier. It's not for protection. It is a passageway. Jesus cares for us and keeps us safe. He wants the best for his sheep, a rich and full life. But to be safe, we need to stay near him. And we need to use discernment because there are more voices calling us than just our shepherd. Following Jesus means refusing to follow others, claiming to be shepherds. The wolves out the sheep with their false teachings or the false idols of the materialistic world. And one who enters the fold through Jesus has the freedom to come in and go out, the freedom to live life in his presence. If we wander off, he looks for us. It is not enough to go through the motions of following Jesus. He wants our heart. So St. Peter's is like a sheepfold. It is a place of safety with Jesus as its gatekeeper. We are the flock, an extended family grown from the loving hearts of the Father and the Son. Father Mike is our new shepherd, and we look to him for guidance. And even though we are sheep, we are at times called to be shepherds, to encourage others to join the flock, to be a witness. The choice is ours, and if we ourselves ever wander from the flock, know that there is someone there to lead us back. Amen.